Good morning all of you. Welcome to our course Database Management System. In today's lecture we are going to discuss a very important topic called as a ER diagram. So before starting this topic we should know why do we require ER diagram? What is the importance of ER diagram? Why it is being asked to draw ER diagram before development of a database? See, as I already given you the example that ER diagram is somehow synonymous with concept of flowchart. Whenever you are developing a particular program, before developing the program you have draw flowchart. Flowchart is a diagrammatic representation of any program. Similarly, ER diagram is a diagrammatic representation of your database. So it's better before developing any database you need to draw a ER diagram. So again I will give one real life example to understand the use of a ER diagram, why drawing of ER diagram or why developing a flowchart is important before writing any program. It is not a case that suppose you not develop ER diagram then you will not able to implement a database for particular project or particular organization, but suppose you are following this practice then your database development should be a proper one. So I will give one real life example. Whenever we are going to build a house, so at that time we'll take advice from architect. So what is the role of architect? Architect will prepare one diagram, one plan, and according to that plan we build our house. So there are two cases. In case one, suppose we have not taken any kind of suggestion or advice from architect, we didn't have any particular plan before starting building up our house. And case two, we have taken a appropriate plan from a architect before starting building up our house. So in both the two cases, which one is beneficial? So in case one, I have not taken any plan or any diagram or any map. So in that case, there may be an issue. Once I build a hall and then after that suppose I want to build a bedroom or kitchen, in that case suppose I need to change a position, change a size, it's very difficult. So for that purpose I need to do a lot of things. But this is not a case in case 2. In case 2 everything is planned, means everything is decided that this will be the size of a hall, this will be the size of kitchen, this will be the size of a bedroom, this will be the position. So everything is fixed, everything I have drawn on that particular paper. So it will be very easy for building a house. But in the case one you may face a lot of issues. That's why before developing a database for any organization or any project, it is important to develop a ER diagram, because ER diagram represent a diagrammatic representation of a database. What ER diagram consists of? Generally ER diagram consists of three things. What are they? Entity, relationship and attributes. So one by one we'll understand what is entity, what is relationship and what is attribute. But before that I think you should be clear what is ER diagram. So in short we can say that ER diagram is nothing but a diagrammatic representation of your database. Now we'll start from basic, that is entity. See, entity is nothing but an object. As you learn about object oriented programming, in object oriented programming you might have heard about object. So that object is nothing but an entity. So how can we define entity? Entity is a thing or object in the real world that is distinguishable from all other objects. So in short you need to remember entity is nothing but an object, and that object should be distinguishable from other object. Say for example person. Person in an organization will represent one entity, student will represent one entity, teacher will represent one entity, course will represent one entity. Say, so they are other objects. Next one is entity set. So what is the difference between entity and entity set? Entity is one and entity set is group of entity. But in that case what is important? Group of entity of a same type. So I can say student, means in order to represent single student I will represent entity as a student. Suppose I want to represent multiple student, then also I use student. So I can say student is a entity also and student is a entity set also. So entity is a single and entity set is a group of entity. So this is what a entity set. Now next is a relationship. So what is relationship? Relationship is nothing but a association between many entity. For example, I have two entity. One entity is a student and second entity is a course. So what kind of relationship exists between student and course? So I can say enroll. Enroll is a relationship between student and course. So what I can say, student enroll in the course. So enroll is a relationship, or we can say association. So relationship is very important because in your database you may have n number of entities, but relationship is important in order to interact between n number of entities are there. So entity, sorry, relationship tells us how one entity is related to another entity. And relationship can be thought of as a verb linking to two or more noun. I just given the example, enroll is a relationship between student and course. Similarly, between student and teacher, what kind of relationship exists? We can say teacher teach student. So teach is a relationship between student and teacher. So this is what a relationship. Now next one is attribute. So what do you mean by attribute? See, in order to represent a particular entity, we require some set of feature. For example, student is there. How to represent a student? So student is represented with the help of its attributes. So what are the attributes of the student, or what are the features of the student? Roll number, name, contact number, email ID, address. These are the features of a student. So this feature help us to represent that particular entity. So attribute is nothing but a feature that is represented that help us to represent the any particular entity. So in short, you need to remember, attribute is nothing but a feature of that particular entity. So there are various types of attributes are there, so that we are going to discuss one by one. First category is simple attribute and composite attribute, single value attribute and multi-value attribute, stored attribute and derived attribute, as well as the complex attribute. So we'll discuss very first how what is simple attribute, how simple attribute is different from composite attribute. So simple attribute is that kind of attribute which consists of a single atomic value and which cannot be further subdivided. What is the importance of simple attribute? Simple attribute is that attribute which is having single atomic value and that cannot be further subdivided. For example, your roll number, your age, college ID, enrollment number, all these are the examples of simple attribute because they are not going to further subdivided into sub-part. Now, opposite of simple attribute, there is a composite attribute. So what is composite attribute? Composite attribute is that attribute which can be further subdivided into parts. For example, address. I can say address is a composite attribute. Why? Because address is further subdivided into many parts. For example, house number, city, state, area, and so on. That means address is further subdivided into many parts. Then next one is name. Another example is name. Can we say that name is further subdivided into many parts? So answer is yes. First name, middle name, last name, these are the parts of name. So this is a category of simple attribute and composite attribute. Now next category we have single value attribute and multi-value attribute. So what is single value attribute? The attribute that holds only a single value. So again the example is age of a person, enrollment number of a person, a student, customer ID. So they are the examples of single value attribute. And what is multi-value attribute? The attribute that holds multiple value. An attribute that holds multiple value is treated as a multi-value attribute. So we'll take a simple example, email ID. One person may have multiple email ID, one person may have multiple contact numbers, one person may have many address, say temporary address, and permanent address. So they are the examples of multi-value attribute. Now next category is stored attribute and the derived attribute. So first we understand what is derived attribute. Derived attribute is that attribute which derives its value from another attribute. So simple example is age of a person. How will you calculate a age of particular person? Suppose you know a date of birth of a particular person, then easily you can calculate what is the age of a person. So age of a person can be calculated from the attribute called as a date of birth. So I can say that date of birth is a stored attribute, whereas age is a derived attribute. Why age is a derived attribute? Because what I told you, what is a derived attribute? Derived attribute are those attributes whose value is derived from another attribute. So here the value of age, we can derive it from the date of birth. And date of birth is a stored attribute. So what is stored attribute? Stored attribute are those attributes which help other attribute to derive its value. Okay, so this is the concept of stored attribute and derived attribute. Then finally we have one more type of attribute, that is a complex attribute. So what is complex attribute? Complex attribute is a both composite and multi-value attribute. So what is the meaning of composite? Composite means what? The attribute which is further subdivided into many parts. And multi-value attribute means what? The attribute which can have multiple values. So can you tell me what is the example of complex attribute? So its very good example is address. Now why address is a complex attribute? Because address is both composite as well as multi-value. As we can split address into many parts such as city, state, country, pin code, area, okay? And address means one person may have multiple address, that means temporary address as well as a permanent address. That's why address is an example of complex attribute. So I hope you understand what are the different types of attributes. Okay, so we have discussed various categories over here: simple attribute, composite attribute, single value attribute, multi-value attribute, stored attribute and derived attribute, and the complex attribute. Simple attribute means what? Which cannot be further subdivided. Composite attributes are further subdivided into many parts. Single value attribute is having only single value. Multi-value attribute is having multiple values. Stored attribute means attribute from which another attribute will derive its value. Derived attributes are those which derive its value from stored attribute. And complex attributes are those which is both composite and multi-value. So this is what a concept of attributes. Now the next topic is types of relationship. Before that we discuss what is relationship. Now the next topic is types of relationship. What that relationship represent? Relationship represent the kind of association between two or more entity. So there are various types of relationship that may exist between two entity. So there are four types are there, and these types of relationship is also called as a mapping cardinalities. So there are four types of mapping cardinalities are there: one to many, one to one, many to one, and many to many. So one by one we'll discuss all this thing. Very first thing is one to one. First type of relationship is one to one. So in this diagram, what you understand, see, this is a complete entity set. As I told you, what is the difference between entity and entity set? Entity is a single, whereas entity set is a group of entity. So here I can say that capital A, this complete circle treated as a capital A, which is an entity set, whereas A1, A2 and A3, these are a entity. Similarly here B1, B2, B3, B4, these are the entity which is a part of entity set capital B. So what is one-to-one kind of relationship? What is the meaning of this? So in that case we can say that one entity in set A is related to exactly one entity in set B. See, again I am repeating what I am telling you. one entity in set A is related to exactly one entity in set B, as well as only one entity in set B is related to exactly one entity in set A. So this is what a one-to-one kind of relationship. Here you can see that A1 entity in set A is related to exactly one entity, that is B1 in set B. How to read this particular diagram? You need to read this from left to right. So this is one-to-one kind of relationship. Similarly, you have one-to-many kind of relationship. So here what you can say, again, one entity in set A is related to any number of entity in set B, or many entity in set B is related to exactly one entity in set A. See, generally we read this particular diagram from left to right manner, and we are discussing about one to many. So how that one to many can be represented? One entity in set A is associated with many entities in a set B. So this is one to many kind of relationship. Next one is many to one. So in many to one, what you can say, many entities in set A is related to exactly one entity in set B. So this is called as a many to one kind of relationship. So you are going to read this diagram in left to right. Here you can observe many entities such as A1, A2, A3 are related to one entity in set B, that is B1. Then fourth type of relationship is many to many kind of relationship. Here many entity in set A is related to many entities in set B. So here you can observe this multiple entities from A is associated with multiple entities in set B. So this is many to many kind of relationship. So these are the four types of mapping cardinality or types of relationship, which are very useful while drawing a ER diagram. Now next one is, what are the symbols that we are going to use to draw the ER diagram? Okay, basically we are using mostly three symbols are important for us. One is a rectangle, which is used to represent any entity. Here rectangle is used to represent single entity. Then to represent a relationship, we use diamond. Diamond is used to represent relationship between two entity. Then attribute is represented by ellipse. So there are a number of symbols that we are going to use whenever we are going to draw ER diagram, but main three symbols that we are going to use while drawing ER diagrams are rectangle, diamond and ellipse. Rectangle represent entity, diamond represent relationship, and ellipse will represent attribute. So we have discussed various types of attribute. Suppose simple attribute is there, that is represented by simple ellipse. Suppose I need to represent multi-value attribute, say contact number, it is represented by double ellipse. Suppose I want to represent derived attribute, then it is represented by dotted ellipse. Okay, then suppose you want to represent weak entity. So what is weak entity? That we are going to discuss in next topic. Here you need to only understand which symbol is used for which purpose. So weak entity is represented by double rectangle. Then double diamond is used for representing identifying relationship. Then primary key attribute is represented by underline. Okay, in this ellipse, that A is underline. Then here we are going to use total participation. Then this will represent discriminating attribute. See, whenever we are going to discuss concept of weak entity and strong entity, at that time you will understand this particular symbol. Weak entity set, discriminating attribute, total participation, identifying relationship. All these are the concepts, or you can say symbols, which are used when you have weak entity and strong entity. And then types of relationship is represented by this will represent many to many kind of relationship. This symbol will represent many to one. This symbol will represent one to many, sorry, one to one. And another symbol we can have over here is a kind of relationship. Okay, is a kind of relationship. It is a extended ER feature. See, we have three extended ER feature: generalization, specialization, and aggregation. So whenever we need to represent this concept in ER diagram, we have to use is a kind of relationship. So I hope you understand three topics in ER diagram. First we discuss what is entity, what is relationship, then we discuss about what is attributes, what are the types of attributes, then we discuss about a relationship, what are the different types of relationship, one to one, one to many, many to one, and many to many. Then we discuss about various symbols that we use while drawing a ER diagram. Okay, so here we'll stop, and remaining part of this ER diagram we'll discuss in next lecture. Thank you.